Now, okay, it's time. So let me start the last talk of the last day of this workshop. So the last talk will be given by Takahiro Sagawa from the University of Tokyo. So he will talk about characterizing complexity of many-body quantum dynamics by high-order eigenstate thermalization. Okay, Takahiro, please.
Yes, thank you for your introduction, Jedon. And I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to talk in this workshop. Today, I'm talking about a characterization of complexity of many-body quantum dynamics by introducing a high-order extension of the eigenstate summarization hypothesis. So this is the motivation of this research. So I'm interested in a unified framework for several notions of quantum chaos, such as eigenstate summarization, information scrambling, and unitary design. That is a concept in quantum information theory. And actually, we have introduced a higher order extension of the ETH, eigenstate summarization hypothesis that we refer to as the KETH, where K equals 1 or 2 or 3 or more. And the one ETH is just a conventional ETH that describes summarization of isolated quantum many-body systems at the level of the expectation value of observables. On the other hand, the higher order ETHs, for example, the KETH corresponds to the Page correction of the eigenstate K Rényi entanglement entropy, as I will show later. And also the KETH corresponds to a special case of the partial unitary design, partial unitary K design. That is also a concept in quantum information theory. Okay, so this is outline of today's talk. I will begin with the definition of the higher order extension of the ETH and KETH. And then I will show the relationship between the KETH and the eigenstate Page curve of the Rényi entanglement entropy. And then I will show our numerical results on the validation of the two ETH in non-integrable models. And then I will introduce a quantum information theoretic concept called partial unitary design and discuss its relationship to the KETH. And finally, I will summarize my talk. Okay, so let me start with the definition of the higher order ETH. But before that, let me just briefly remind what is the conventional eigenstate summarization hypothesis. So very roughly speaking, the ETH states that even a single energy eigenstate can be regarded as a summary equilibrium state. For example, if we pick up just a single energy eigenstate from the energy shell of the Hamiltonian, then and if we take the ensemble average of some observable, then it is very close to the microcanonical average and should be the same in the thermodynamic limit. So this is the idea of the ETH. And it is easy to see that this is a sufficient condition for summarization, because if the ETH is true, then the long time average equals the microcanonical average for arbitrary initial states. So in this sense, the ETH is a representation of the quantum ergodicity. And also by a lot of numerical experiments, it has been established that the ETH holds for generic non-integrable systems, except for some exceptions like quantum many-body scars. Okay, so and naive expectation behind the ETH is that chaotic Hamiltonian dynamics behave like random unitary dynamics. That is, this type of unitary operation generated by some Hamiltonian should be regarded as a kind of a random unitary operator. Here, random unitary means the whole random unitary that is sampled from a circular unitary ensemble. And the expectation value of this whole random ensemble is just a uniform average over the Hilbert space. On the other hand, the real Hamiltonian dynamics described by the Schrödinger equation is not actually how random, but it is just a single parameter ensemble. I mean, so if we pick up some time randomly from this time axis, then we have the long time ensemble defined by this. So this is clearly different from the Hall random ensemble, and the ensemble average over this ensemble is just a long time average. So this describes the rate time behavior, typical rate time behavior of the Hamiltonian dynamics described by the Schrödinger equation. So the question is how this long time average equals the Hall random average, because these ensembles are mathematically very different. And to connect these two ensembles, so we introduced the concept called the K-fold channel that is very commonly used in quantum information theory. So to formulate it, we prepare K replicas of the quantum many-body system described by the Hilbert space H. And we consider the case moment of the dynamics. For example, in this case, the system is just a one-dimensional chain, and we prepare K replicas of it, and there is no interaction between these replicas. So the dynamics of the entire system is described by this type of tensor product unitary operator. Then the K-fold channels is defined like this. Here we have the unitary operator here, and all its general operator on the entire Hilbert space of K replicas. And nu is some ensemble. And then we take the ensemble average of this Heisenberg picture observable with respect to the ensemble nu. And then we get the K-fold channel of this ensemble. So this is a schematic to represent the meaning of the average here. Okay, and by using this concept, we can reconsider the definition of the ETH. So this is a representation of the conventional ETH, one ETH, by using the one-fold channel, K equals one. And the left-hand side is the long time ensemble, and the right-hand side is a uniform Hall random ensemble. So we can see that this is actually equivalent to the conventional ETH given by this. The left-hand side is given by the diagonal ensemble, and the diagonal element is given by this against the expectation value. On the other hand, the right-hand side is given by the microcanonical average like this. So we can say that this is equivalent to the conventional ETH. The left-hand side is eigenstate expectation value, and the right-hand side is the microcanonical average. So we can start from this one-fold channel representation of the ETH, and then we can generalize it to the higher orders. Okay, so this is our first definition of the KETH. So this can be regarded as a case order quantum ergodicity, because the left-hand side is a long time average of the case order, and the right-hand side is a Hall random average of the case order. And technically, we assume that the Hamiltonian satisfies the K incommensurate condition, that is a generalized no resonance condition of the energy spacing of the Hamiltonian. And after some calculations, we can derive a more explicit formula for the KETH. So this is a little complicated, but the left-hand side is basically the matrix elements of some observable O with respect to the energy eigenbasis. On the right-hand side is a more complicated, but we have here the Weingarten matrix, and W is a permutation operator defined by this. So I will see some implications of this general and a little complicated representation.
So before going on, can you specify the operator O? So you have some identical replica of the system. So basically non-interacting time evolution.
Exactly, yeah.
Then what about O?
O is a general operator acting on the entire Hilbert space of K replicas.
Entire Hilbert space.
Yeah. Okay. And so by,
O includes some coupling of local operator in the first replica and the last replica.
Exactly, all kinds of, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All can be arbitrary.
Okay.
So by considering this, essentially we want to consider the case moment of the original system.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we choose O properly, then we can, for example, calculate the case moment or the case cumulant of the original single system. So okay. This is the reason why we introduced the concept of K-fold channel here.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so the problem with that is the KTH really new or not? First, if we consider the tensor product form of the operator given by this, this is just a tensor product of K replicas, then the KETH reduces to the diagonal 1ETH and the off-diagonal ETH, except for the subleading terms. In other words, if we look at only the leading terms, the higher order ETH is just a conventional ETH in this case. In this sense, this is not essentially new. But on the other hand, if we consider non-local operators, not in the tensor product form, then we can show that the KETH cannot reduce to the conventional ETH. In that sense, the KETH is new in this case. An important example of such an operator is the partial swap operator that swaps partial systems of these two replicas. And this is physically important because this gives the page curve of the eigenstate entanglement entropy in terms of the Reni entanglement entropy. So I will focus on this case because it gives us some non-trivial information about the original system. Okay. And let me focus on the simplest case, that is a 2ETH. So in this case, the permutation group is just given by the identity and a swap operator. And we have these expressions for the 2ETH. So this is the original general form, and we can reduce this to these three formulas. So the first one is the diagonal ETH. Here we have II here. And the second one is also a kind of diagonal ETH. And here we have IJ and IJ. And the last one is of diagonal ETH, where we have IJ and JI. So these are the general expression of the two ETH. And in the case that the operator is given by the tensor product form, we can explicitly show that the 2ETH reduced to the conventional ETH. Because for the diagonal part, this is just a conventional diagonal ETH. And for the off-diagonal part, this is again the conventional off-diagonal ETH. And these terms are very small and subleading terms. In this sense, in this case, the 2ETH does not give new information about the original system. And
there is a question by Dominic.
Yeah, thanks. Could you go a slide back?
Yes. Please. This one?
Yeah, so I wasn't quite understanding what this S means.
Okay.
So yeah, I don't get it. Why S?
Here.
Yeah. So what am I looking at? Why I have no S on the left-hand side and some S on the right-hand side?
Okay. So the original formula is this, and the left-hand side is some matrix elements, and the right-hand side includes some permutation operator. And the two ETH case, we only have the swap operator, and we need some expectation value of O and its swapped operator over here.
Or the swap comes from the W, the Weingarten matrix, or?
Exactly right, yeah. This W is swapping in the two ETH
case. Oh, I see, that's the picture you have down there. So it reduces to swap if you have just two-dimensional, well, not two-dimensional, exactly. Two tensors. Okay, I see.
Yeah.
And the O is general, right? So
exactly.
I wonder if you are doing something like a permutation theory in O being some kind of tensor product of two local ones, and then
yeah.
In the next slide, actually.
Yeah.
So this is a, you assume O to be like a permutation expansion around some local operator, or?
Yeah, in this case, O is just given by A tensor A. So the swap doesn't affect here.
But then, didn't you say that this then reduces to the standard EDH?
Yeah, sorry, so this is a standard ETH, but for just for a single operator, I mean the standard one ETH.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah. So if the two ETH, yeah.
Tensor product for the operator O, then exactly, it reduces yeah. to the conventional ETH.
Yeah, that's for right. This single A, single operator A.
Oh, so there's like identity in the second one? Or?
Yeah, so in this case, O is given by A tensor A.
Okay.
And yeah, the left-hand side of these ones. And but in that case, so the left-hand side is just a product of the matrix elements of A, for example, AII multiplied by AII. And the right-hand side is obtained after some calculation of this.
Yeah, I still don't get how this is not exactly the same as the standard ETH, because previously, like two slides back, you said that for operators which are tensor products,
yeah,
it's the standard ETH.
Essentially, yes.
But the formula says that some higher order corrections. So.
Exactly. Yeah. Actually, except for the subleading terms. So if we only look at the leading terms, the two ETH is the same as conventional.
I see.
Yeah.
And leading means that it scales with N or?
With N, with the system size.
Aha, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So actually in numerical experiments, we cannot see these subleading terms. So maybe these reading terms are relevant. Yeah. Thank you. So next, I will talk about the relationship between the KETH and information scrambling. So information scrambling is a kind of delocalization of quantum information or quantum chaos. Also, as mentioned in the previous talk. So this was first introduced in the community of string theory, and they considered some sort of experiment of black hole information paradox or Hawking radiation. And the information scrambling is quantified by the out of time ordered correlators, again, as mentioned in the previous talk. Here we have an unconventional ordering of time, T0 here. And if the information is scrambled, then the OTOC decays. For example, if these two operators commute, then the OTOC have a large value. In this case, we suppose that these operators are Pauli matrices. And if these operators don't commute, then the OTOC is close to zero. And from this, we can see that if the information is scrambled and these operators do not commute, then the OTOC decays. And we can also introduce a higher order OTOCs like this. For example, if we consider 2K point OTOC, we have 2K operators here with the time ordering T0, T0, T0. And this is also related to the K-fold channel. And we can analytically show that the exact K-ETH implies the exact K-scrambling described by this 2K point OTOC. In particular, the 2ETH, exact 2ETH implies the standard information scrambling where K equals 2. Here, the left-hand side is ensemble long time average with the 2K point OTOC, and the right-hand side is the hard random average with the 2K point OTOC. So in this sense, at the level of exact calculation, the KETH is almost equivalent to information scrambling. So this can be regarded as a unified view between the ETH and the OTOC information scrambling. But on the other hand, if we consider the approximation of the ETH and the information scrambling, the relationship between these two is not so straightforward. Because in real quantum many body systems like XXZ model or something like that, the KETH cannot be true exactly. So we need to consider some approximate ETH and the error should be punished in the thermodynamic limit. And actually in this paper, they showed that the approximate information scrambling can be obtained only from the approximate one ETH. And moreover, we have shown that the contribution from the two ETH is much smaller than the finite size effect in this setup. So in this sense, we can say that in quantum many body systems, the relationship between the case order quantum ergodicity and the case order information scrambling is not very straightforward. Actually, the finite size effect is dominant. And then I will discuss the relationship between the KETH and the eigenstate page curve of Reni entanglement entropy. So this is the definition of the Reni entanglement entropy. And we divide, for example, the spin chain into two regions, X and Y. And we can compute the Reni entanglement entropy by this formula. And if K equals 1, this is just a standard von Neumann entropy. This quantity can be experimentally measured by using ultra-cold atoms, or we can measure it in numerical experiments. And this is a page curve, and this region, this difference is called the page correction. And we now focus on the partial swap operator, because the Reni entanglement entropy can be written as the expectation value of the swapping operator here, if we consider two replicas of the original spin chain. And if we consider the two ETH for this swapping operator here, and we can use the diagonal part of the two ETH, and we can derive this formula. On the left-hand side is the eigenstate Reni 2 entanglement entropy, and the right-hand side is given by two terms. The first term is given by the standard microcanonical entanglement entropy, and the right-hand side is given by the correction term that comes from the two ETH. And the important point is, as I will show later, this term is greater than the finite size effect, and this term is actually relevant and not negligible. And if we take the thermodynamic limit where n is very large, then we have the two contributions. The first one is the volume of entanglement entropy, and the second term is the page correction. So this is exactly the same form as the standard page correction. And in our framework, this can be obtained from the two ETH correction. And also, if we take small n equals capital N over 2, then the first term is just a standard entropy, volume or raw entropy, and the second term is given by log 2. So this is exactly the same as the standard page correction. So in summary, we can say that from 1 ETH, we can obtain the volume raw entanglement entropy, and from the 2 ETH, you can exactly reproduce the page correction term. So this is the main message of this part. Okay, so then I will go to our numerical validation of the 2 ETH. As I mentioned before, in real quantum many body systems, the ETH cannot be true exactly. So we should consider some indicator of the error of the ETH. For example, in this case, we take a kind of the max norm here. And this takes the worst case of the deviation from the exact KETH. And if this indicator of the error vanishes, then we say that the KETH is true approximately. So this formulation is very standard in the case of the conventional 1 ETH. For example, in this paper, they adapted the same indicator of the error, and they showed that this error scales exponentially with respect to the system size. And in standard terminology, this approximate 1 ETH is called the strong ETH or just the ETH. So what we want to check numerically is that the validity of the approximate 2 ETH or a strong 2 ETH by using the same indicator as this, and we want to see the exponent of the exponential decay. And this is our model, and our Hamiltonian is this radar model, a radar type Hamiltonian, and we have the XXZ model for each chain, and the coupling between these chains is described by lambda, and if lambda is zero, this model is integrable, and if lambda is not zero, this model is not integrable. And also in this model, the 1 ETH is well established by numerical experiments, for example, in this paper. Okay, so this is our numerical result for the non-integrable case, lambda equals 1. So in the case of the tensor product operator, the error indicator decays like this, and this is actually the exponential decay with respect to the system size. And in the case of the swapping operator, we again see the exponential decay of the error indicator. So in these cases, the 2 ETH is actually true. And also we can observe that in this case, if the swapping region is 1 or 2 or 3, I mean, if the swapping region is fixed, then the decay rate is the same as the tensor product form. But if we take the swapping region as the half of this radar model, I mean, the swapping region equals L, L is here, then the decay exponent is different from these other three cases. So I will quantitatively show the difference in the next slide. Okay, so we have computed the exponent of the exponential decay with respect to the system size. And this is a tensor product case, and we have a universal exponent that is 1/2 here, except for the integrable case. And we can see that all of these cases in the non-integrable cases, that 2 ETH is clearly true, even if the non-integrable term is very small. On the other hand, in the swapping operator case, we again have the universal exponent 1/2, except for the integrable case. But only in the case that the swapping is non-local and it is proportional to the system size, then we have another universal exponent that is given by 1. So this is a summary of these exponents. And in the integrable case, the 2 ETH is not true for all of these cases. On the other hand, if the operators are local, we have exponent 1/2, but this, in this case, the half swap operator case, we have the exponent, exponent 1. So this behavior can be understood from the random matrix theory, because in only in this half swap case, we can consider another random matrix behind this. And I would like to also emphasize, yes.
Dominic?
Yes, sorry, I missed. What is the D and A? So D is the dimension of the system, or what is D and A?
Yes, D is the Hilbert space dimension of the system.
Oh, that's why you said it's exponential, because in the previous slide it was like D to the minus A. So I was.
Yes.
Because system the dimension size is E to the N, I guess.
Yes, exactly. D is given by E to N.
Uh-huh.
And N is the system then? Size.
What is A?
A is the exponent here.
But what's the physical meaning of it?
It's the rate of the decay of the error term. This, I mean, the deviation between the exact ETH and the approximate ETH.
So that's fitted experimentally, or?
Exactly, by numerically we fit this, yeah.
Oh, I see, okay, thanks.
So yeah, from random matrix theory, we can compute these exponents and we can reproduce this 1/2 and 1 here. And also I would like to emphasize that a larger exponent is consistent with the phase correction. If this was 1/2, then maybe the phase correction could be smaller than the finite size effect. But in reality, we can see the phase correction that is greater than the finite size effect. And that is actually consistent with this greater exponent here. Okay, so finally, let me discuss the relationship between the KTH and the partial unitary design, that is a quantum information theoretic concept. First, let me start with the standard ordinary unitary K design. So very roughly speaking, unitary K design is an ensemble that can simulate the Hall random unitary only up to the kth moment. So the real Hall random unitary is truly random up to all of the moments, but now we only require that the unitary K design can simulate the randomness only up to the finite order, that is up to the kth moment. And the definition of the unitary K design is given by this, and for all operators in the operator space, the k-fold channel of the ensemble mu equals the k-fold channel of the k-fold channel of the Hall random unitary. So this is the definition of the unitary K design. But this is a kind of a bit strong, too strong definition in terms of the K, in terms of the ETH. Because, for example, the long time ensemble is not a unitary K design, because it should conserve the energy. So if we substitute the energy against it to the 1/4 channel, for example, then the energy against it should not be changed. But if we consider the Hall random unitary, then the energy against it should be completely mixed. So in that sense, any long time ensemble generated by the Hamiltonian cannot be a unitary K design. So to get the relationship between the unitary design and the ETH, we should relax this definition by removing this requirement, or it's an arbitrary operator. For example, in this case, the energy against it is an exception for this definition. And this is also physically reasonable, because in rare experiments, we can expect that only a small part of observables in the operator space can be experimentally measured, unless we have a universal quantum computer. So in this sense, the summarization problem can be understood as a problem that given the condition that we can only observe a small part or small subset of the operator space, it cannot be, the dynamics cannot be distinguished from the whole random unitary. So we now introduce a concept called the partial unitary K design. And here, this is essentially the same, almost the same as the ordinary unitary K design case, but we only require that the observable is on a small subset of the operator space that is written as A. And given this definition, the KETH for observable on a subset of the operator space is can be regarded as the partial unitary K design of the long time ensemble of the same subset. So in this sense, we can regard the KETH as a special case of the partial unitary K design. So in this sense, we can get some unified view between the ETH and unitary design. But we should relax the original definition of the unitary K design by removing this condition. And finally, I show some examples of partial unitary designs that are not full unitary design. So the simplest and trivial example is just a single unitary operator. In this case, the ensemble is given by just this operator, and there is no randomness at all. In this case, the subset on which this ensemble becomes a partial unitary K design is given by this. This is just generated by the identity and swapping operator. So there are just two generators, and this is a very small subset. On the other hand, a more interesting example is Pauli ensemble. So this is the ensemble uniformly distributed over many body Pauli operators like this. And the subset on which this Pauli ensemble becomes a partial unitary 2 design is given by this. So here we have many generators, the identity and swapping and these Pauli operators. And the number of the generators of this subset is given by this. So the number of generators of the entire operator space is d to the fourth. So this is very close to the entire operator space. So from these examples, we can see that by considering partial unitary design, we can quantify the randomness of the ensemble of operators. For example, this is the randomness of this is very small, but the randomness of Pauli ensembles is very large, and it is almost the same as the full unitary design. Okay, so let me summarize this talk. So we have introduced the higher order extension of the eigenstate summarization hypothesis in terms of the k-fold channel of the long time ensemble and the Hall random unitary. And we have derived explicit expression of the KETH given by this. And we have discussed the relationship between the KETH and the information scrambling and page correction of the linear entanglement entropy and partial unitary designs. And we have also numerically checked the validity of the 2ETH for non-integral systems. Okay, so this is the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for a nice talk. Is there any question or comment? So I have some question. So you demonstrate the validity of the 2 ETH numerically. And
yeah.
Is it for the diagonal case or in the standard ETH, there is a diagonal ETH and off-diagonal ETH. So
yeah. This includes everything. I mean, so this is the worst case over the diagonal and off-diagonal ETHs. So this sigma is a permutation. So we take the worst case of every patterns of energy against it, diagonal and off-diagonal.
Okay. And you mentioned some ladder system, okay?
Yeah.
So is it correct? I mean, the 2 ETH, is it equivalent to the 1 ETH on this particular ladder system where you don't have without interchain interaction? Is that correct?
You mean lambda coupling here?
No coupling.
In the case of the no coupling, this is an integrable system. And these are not replicas. So this is a single system.
Yeah, yeah. What I mean is that I have only a single chain. Okay.
Yeah.
And I want to ask about the 2 ETH for this single chain system.
Yeah.
Then, you know, to do that, you need to have one replica. Okay.
Yeah.
And then you introduce some local operator extending between these two chains. But in the end, the final configuration is equivalent to the ladder system, and one single ladder system where you do not have interaction between two chains.
Exactly, yeah.
So can I understand, interpret your 2 ETH in terms of 1 ETH of this ladder system? Some extended.
So actually, I don't think so because this is exactly this. So I mean, if we look at only the tensor product operators, so the 2 ETH of the single system is almost equivalent to the 1 ETH of the radar system up to these subleading terms.
Mm-hmm.
But we need to consider, for example, non-local operators and not in the tensor product form. And in this case, the 2 ETH of the original system is not equivalent to the 1 ETH of the entire system, the replica system.
Okay.
Yeah, so in that sense, this is essentially the new part.
Okay. Okay. There is another question by Dominic.
Yes. So I'm trying to wrap my head around what this actually means physically. So does the 1 ETH talks about thermalization of a single system with some, let's say, non-integral Hamiltonian.
Yeah.
So then I guess the 2 ETH is that you have two systems that are completely independent. They evolve. They evolve independently, right? Because you are considering Hamiltonians that tensor products. But then the observables are such that the eigenvectors of those observables are entangled. So something like making measurement in Bell basis on these independent systems, right? It talks about these kind of situations. Is that correct?
Yeah. So you mean you have two systems? And the inter-evolution is independent with each other. And so maybe I couldn't get your point. So
I just wonder because it says ETH works, therefore it tells you about the thermalization of some local observables, right?
Yeah.
The 2 ETH tells you about thermalization of observables that are somehow entangled in the basis of this tensor product Hilbert space. which evolve with Hamiltonians that are also tensor products, so they are actually not interacting.
In some sense, yes, yeah, but yeah, in some sense, yes, but I, in my understanding, the most unique feature of the two ETH is represented by the Rényi entanglement entropy, the page correction of the Rényi entanglement entropy, because the most non-trivial part is, for example, this partial swap operator, non-local partial swap operator. So and this is directly related to the definition of the Rényi entanglement entropy. So this is the reason why the two ETH is directly related to the page correction.
Oh, I see. So this is exactly the example of what I was trying to say is that you have two, let's say, independent systems, but the operator you are trying to consider is like an entangling operator between the two systems.
Yes, and I think so, yeah. So,
So then the question arises like, what do you get for some other interesting operators, right? Yeah, if you get something so nice for a page curve and pop, then maybe there'll be many some interesting graphs that you can draw.
That's exactly what I'm interested in. So I haven't thought about other operators than the half swap operator, but I think there should be several interesting other cases in which the two ETH is relevant. Yeah, I want to investigate for that direction.
That sounds awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so if I understand correctly, so as an operator O, if we include that kind of exchange, some local operator between replica, then you will have some independent result from the one ETH. Is that correct?
Okay. That's right. Yeah, I think. So the important point is O should have some entanglement between these two systems. Otherwise, it reduces to the conventional case.
And you also mentioned the OTOCA. How can your KETH provides some useful information for the understanding of this Lyapunov exponent?
Yeah, it's a little bit subtle problem because the Lyapunov exponent is a short time behavior of the OTOC.
Yes.
It's right. On the other hand, here we consider the long time average of the OTOC. So it's about the long time region. So it's for different time regions, short and long. So the connection is not straightforward.
Okay.
I think. Yeah.
Okay. Is there any other question? Okay, if not, then let's thank the speaker again. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And also, I'd like to thank all the speakers of this session, and Otto, Smilan, and Takayo. Okay.